My little sister used to be a VTuber. For convenience sake, I'll call her Susie, and her VTuber persona, Suzuki. Susie and I couldn't have been more different. She was a quiet girl who didn't go out much, and I was a social butterfly who loved getting to know new people. Still, we were as close as a couple of sisters could be, thanks to our shared interests. We often bonded over our mutual love of anime and video games, so when she told me she wanted to become a VTuber after we moved into the same apartment after high school, I was fully supportive of the idea. I thought that it could be a good way to get Susie to open up to people in a safe way. She wouldn't have to go outside, which she didn't like to do anyways, and she could talk through a fictional avatar so she didn't have to worry about showing her real face online for strangers to see. Both of us had loved to draw ever since we were kids, so I helped her come up with a design for her VTuber persona, as well as the backstory and personality she'd play for her. We ended up with Suzuki, a half-American transfer student to Japan who doesn't speak Japanese but is trying her best to learn, sometimes on stream. Suzuki was the complete opposite to Susie. She was a bubbly, red-headed anime girl who always greeted her viewers with a hearty, "Heyo, you guys," while the real person behind her was a quiet brunette who spent most of her life as a background character in everyone else's story. To make her sound even more cutesy during the streams, we even downloaded a live voice changer on her computer to make her sound more high-pitched. I only realized after we'd finalized the character design that Suzuki shared an uncanny resemblance to me and even had a similar personality. When I did, I felt a pang of guilt in my chest. Although they never said it aloud, our parents always seemed to favor me over her growing up. If we both had events on the same day, they'd always choose to attend my event, and on our birthdays, my gifts were just a little bit more expensive than hers. Intentionally or not, she must have been trying to make her avatar resemble me because of that childhood favoritism. Nevertheless, I continued to support her VTuber career off stream. I always left her alone whenever I knew she was streaming in her room to not interrupt whatever she was doing. At most, I'd send her a text message on her phone that dinner was ready on the table so that my voice wouldn't be picked up on her live stream. Our neighbor was not as considerate, however. We lived right next to a bitter old woman, who I'll call Liz. Liz was in her 40s, with pale, warty skin, stringy, gray hair, and a perpetual scowl that could make milk go sour. Despite all the soundproof padding we put in Susie's room, she would often stop me in the middle of the hall just to complain about the noise Susie was apparently making with her live streams. I only ever pretended to listen. None of our other neighbors complained, so I was pretty convinced that she watched Susie's live streams as Suzuki and just wanted an excuse to bother us. Probably because she disliked every person younger than her by default. One day I had to go out on a week-long business trip for my company. I was a bit worried about leaving Susie alone, but I didn't exactly have a choice if I wanted to get a promotion at my job. "Are you sure you're gonna be alright?" I asked on the day I was supposed to leave for the trip. "I'll be fine," Susie replied. "My VTuber career's been taking off. I should be able to live off donations until you get back." "Okay, but just in case, I'm leaving you some money in the drawer. Do not forget to take care of yourself, okay? Oh, and avoid Liz like the plague." "You don't need to tell me that twice," Susie said with a chuckle. We shared one last hug, and I left with a traveling bag full of clothes for my business trip. I spent the next week sharing cheap hotel rooms with people I barely knew, and attending business meetings that had me brain dead for the most of it. It was long and boring and made me appreciate my comfortable bed at home all the more. My only highlight for each day was getting to see Susie stream as her Suzuki persona on my phone at the end of each day. Hearing her happy, high-pitched avatar say, "Hey, all you guys," at the start of each stream never failed to put a smile on my face. For the first time, I knew what it felt like to be a regular watcher of her streams, instead of a hidden part of it. It was nice while it lasted. On the day I returned from my trip, I decided to pick up a gift for Susie on the way home at the electronics store. Knowing how dedicated she was to her blossoming VTuber career, I bought a brand new microphone for her to use during her streams. When I returned to our apartment, I headed straight for her room to give her the gift I bought her. I opened her bedroom thinking that I'd see my sister playing video games or watching anime as she usually did during her free time. Instead, my blood ran cold when I saw the person sitting in my sister's chair. Her stringy hair had been dyed the same shade of red as Suzuki, and shoddily tied up in a familiar twin tail style. The warts on her wrinkled face were poorly covered in makeup that was dripping off from the sweat coating her cheeks, and her mouth, usually twisted into an angry scowl, was instead showing off a crazed smile full of crooked yellow teeth. It was Liz, my neighbor. I let out an audible gasp in surprise. The moment I did, Liz snapped her head in my direction. She stared through me with bloodshot eyes filled to the brim with madness as she shouted in a loud, eerily cheerful voice,
"Hey, oh you guys!"
I ran out of the apartment as quickly as I could. One of the neighbors heard the ruckus and opened the door to check what was going on. I told him to call the police and stayed at his apartment until the police came. Liz was giggling like a demented schoolgirl the entire time the police dragged her out of the apartment. After thoroughly searching the apartment, they found Susie tied up in the tub of our bathroom. She had a large bruise on her head where Liz had hit her that was already covered in dry blood by the time she was found. She was extremely thin and malnourished, but still barely clinging to life. The doctor at the hospital told me that she must have been kept in the bathroom without food for at least a week. For an entire week, Liz must have been impersonating my own sister with her VTuber persona. I can only assume that she was trying to regain some of her lost youth, but in doing so, she robbed Susie of hers. Susie's in a coma now, though the doctors are hopeful that she'll make a full recovery someday. In the meantime, I've been keeping her VTuber channel alive by streaming as Suzuki in her stead. I feel bad lying to her fans, but I just couldn't stand the thought of Suzuki fading into obscurity after all the hard work Susie put into her. I still pray for the day my sister wakes up to take back her place. Hey guys, I see many of you commenting on my videos that this channel deserves 1 million subscribers. But I also see the percent of people who watch my videos aren't actually subscribed to the channel. So, if you like the content, want to support my channel, and want to see this channel reach 1 million subscribers, or maybe 500,000 subscribers, then go ahead, subscribe, and hit the bell icon. It's free, and you can always change your mind later. I'd call myself a casual fan of VTubers, especially indie ones without many subscribers. Sometimes I'd even donate a few dollars to them if my paycheck would allow it. There's something about being able to make the day of an up-and-coming talent that just puts a smile on my face. I got to witness the rise of many talented VTubers as a casual viewer, but there is one among them that I will never forget. I first found her one Sunday night as I was browsing through wiki pages to find a VTuber I hadn't seen before, until one of them caught my eye. The wiki listed her name as an English-speaking VTuber named Madame Miriam. The character design was of a typical cute anime girl with blue eyes and braided brown hair. What really made her stick out was her avatar's outfit, a classic fortune teller getup, consisting of a medieval-looking blouse complete with a generous cleavage window, a purple shawl decorated by gold chains, and several golden medallions in the shape of occult symbols hanging from her neck. Most VTubers played a character centered around a certain theme or personality type. Cheerful cat girls, seductive vampires, brash tomboys, you name it. I'd never even seen or heard of a VTuber with a fortune teller theme before, so she immediately caught my interest. My interest in her only grew when I saw her listed sub count and debut date. In the span of a couple of months, she'd somehow reached over 50,000 subscribers on YouTube. That might not seem like much, but it's practically unheard of for a small independent VTuber to grow that fast. I clicked on the link to her YouTube channel and saw that she had a live stream on. I was immediately struck by the view count at that moment. Over 50,000 viewers were watching her. Even popular VTubers with more than a million subscribers typically only have a fraction of their subscribers watch their live streams at any given moment. For this small independent VTuber to have that many people watching her, almost every single one of her subscribers had to be present to watch her. I've seen some pretty dedicated VTuber fandoms before, but something like this should have been impossible by logistics alone. The content of the live stream itself didn't seem like anything special. It just seemed like a casual chatting stream, though her choice of topic was a bit odd.
So, as you all know, I've been trying to unlock my chakras with some new crystals I was able to buy because of all of your generous donations. It's really helped me become more connected with the universe. Now, I can give even more accurate predictions, just for my fans.
Weird, I thought, but it fit with the theme of her fortune teller character, so I didn't find it too strange, and kept the live stream on one screen while I got some errands done on my other screen. Then, I saw someone donate $200 to her in the chat. Attached to it was a message that she read aloud to everyone else watching the stream.
Hey, Madam Miriam. I'm sorry for missing the last stream, so I'm giving you double the usual amount today. I just wanted to know, is there any advice you can give me to get my crush to like me?
The username was nondescript, just a typical nonsense nickname you can find in any YouTube comments section. And yet, in her answer, she referred to the person by an actual name.
Well, Seth, she said, I don't think Sally's going to like you anytime soon, considering that she's already got a boyfriend.
The chat was flooded with oofs, LOLs, and emojis either laughing or crying at her words. I was just surprised how she somehow knew the real name and love life status of a random viewer. I stopped what I was doing to fully focus on her stream.
There is a way to fix that, however, she continued. You actually know her boyfriend. He's the one who works a couple of cubicles away from you at work. His name's Chris, in case you didn't know. But don't worry, if you want to get rid of him, all you have to do is drink 3 full glasses of water from the office water cooler tomorrow morning, before work starts for everyone else.
I was confused. I expected her to say something generic like, there are plenty of fish in the sea, or be assertive. I had no idea why she'd say something so random. If it was a joke, then it must have been an inside one, because I didn't get it at all. But instead of understandable confusion, the chat became filled with messages praising her for her supposed wisdom and wishing Seth good luck stealing Sally away from Chris. I closed the stream, thinking that all Madam Miriam's fans must have been just as weird as she was. Something about what she said bugged me. I actually did know a person named Chris who's dating a girl named Sally in real life. They were my coworkers at work, and I'd sometimes chat with them at the water cooler when there wasn't any work to be done. It was surreal hearing their relationship to be described by some anime girl online in response to a random question. Still, I chalked it up to a coincidence and went to bed. The next day, I drove to my workplace ready for another uneventful day. Instead, I saw smoke coming out of the office building's windows in the distance as I drove there. When I got to the building, there were a dozen fire trucks at the scene, trying to put out the fire on the same floor I worked in. Firefighters streamed out of the building, hauling out injured people on stretchers. I even recognized one of them. It was Chris, or what was left of him at least. He'd been seriously burnt. Half of his face had been burned off, and his entire left arm was so scorched that I could see bulging blue veins and charred bones sticking out of the burnt flesh. I'm no doctor, but even I could tell that he didn't have much longer to live. I walked up to one of the resting firefighters and asked him what had happened here.
A freak accident, he explained. Details are iffy, but according to some witnesses, the janitor was trying to refill the water cooler when he slipped and spilled the water on a faulty electric socket. It caused a spark and, well, all of this happened. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. For something so small and random to be the case of such destruction. The mere thought of it was absurd. I didn't connect what was happening to what I saw the previous day until I saw Sally, Chris's girlfriend, crying on the steps of the building.
Sitting beside her with a comforting hand on her shoulder was a guy I'd seen around the office before, but never bothered to learn the name of. Sally spoke to him through her sobs, and everything finally clicked.
Thank you for being with me,
Sally said to the man.
You're such a good guy, Seth.
I used to want to be a streamer. I loved playing video games and liked talking to people who shared my interests, so I thought that becoming a video game streamer would be right up my alley. I get to do what I enjoy, and potentially get paid for doing it, if enough people enjoy my content. Just one problem. I wasn't confident about my appearance, and I was more than a little nervous about showing my face to everyone on the internet. It might be egotistical for me to think that I'd make it big before I even started, but on the off chance I didn't want to get stopped in the streets by random strangers who recognized me from what I posted online. Plus, there are a lot of creeps on the internet, and I'm a reasonably good-looking girl. Not supermodel material or anything, but I've gotten compliments from people outside my friends and family. The last thing I needed was for some nut job online to develop an unwanted obsession with me. I've heard some pretty bad stories about online stalking that bled into the real world from streamers I follow. If I was going to become a streamer, I wanted there to be a defined barrier between the person I presented myself to be online and who I really was in everyday life. At first, I considered being a streamer who only showed her voice on stream, but after listening to several samples of my own voice recordings, I didn't think my voice was distinct enough to carry an entire stream alone. Just as I was about to give up, my brother, who lived in the same apartment as me and studied animation in university, came up to me with an idea. He told me about the type of streamer called virtual YouTubers, or VTubers for short, that had become popular in recent years. Instead of showing their real face on stream, they show a virtual avatar of an anime character that's mapped to their real face, so that the avatar will blink and open their mouth at the same time as them to simulate talking. It seemed like the perfect solution to me. I got to stream and interact with people online all I wanted, without having to worry about losing my anonymity. I also loved anime like my brother anyways, so pretending to be an anime girl online seemed right up my alley. Since he was an experienced animator, my brother helped me design and map my virtual avatar. He also helped me come up with a theme and backstory for the character I'd play on stream. The character we came up with was Miyako Nightshade, a centuries-old vampire who looked like a teenage girl with a calm, slightly snarky personality. Yeah, I never quite grew out of my goth phase. My brother drew up the design, made the avatar, and taught me how to manage the software. For my part, I started thinking about what kind of catchphrases my online persona should have, and started looking through games to play for my debut. When the big day came for me to debut myself online for the first time, my brother was right there with me in the room to silently support me. I started the stream and almost immediately regretted it. I hadn't even picked a signature greeting for my character yet, but the fact that there wasn't even a viewer on my stream yet helped ease my nervousness enough to just blurt out the first thing I could think of. Good evening, whatever time it is. And with that, my signature greeting for the rest of my VTubing career was decided. The next few months were great. I streamed regularly with my brother helping me off screen with any technical problems that arose. I wasn't quite what you'd call successful yet, but I was getting there. My sub count grew slowly but steadily, and a few of my channel members donated regularly to me. If I kept going, I might have been able to reach a major milestone within a year, had it not been for an incident that made me quit streaming altogether. One day I was streaming as usual. It was an online game, so I was actually playing with a few people who were also watching the stream. One of them, let's call him Donnie, was a regular who watched and donated to almost all of my streams in the past few months. As much as I appreciated his sponsorship, he always kind of weirded me out. I always read his messages on stream because he'd donate high amounts of money, never less than $100. Their contents range from harmless to straight up creepy. The worst ones said things like, "I beg of you, please marry me, my queen. Our love will be eternal as your everlasting beauty. Every drop of blood in my body belongs to you, my pale mistress. I'll give it all to you if you only let me. You are my everything. My heart beats for you, and you alone, my little nightshade. Donnie was either really dedicated to his bit, or clearly mentally unstable. I was pretty convinced that he actually thought I was a vampire anime girl who decided to spend her unlife playing video games. Still, I didn't want to break character, so I never made a big deal about his messages after reading them. He was a fan who donated money that allows me to keep streaming, so I felt it wrong to push him away for a few quirks. Besides, beggars can't be choosers, right? Halfway through my game with him, my brother called out to me from outside my room. He usually wouldn't disturb my stream like that, but I'd forgotten to tell him that I was streaming that day, and he wanted to know what I wanted for dinner. I quietly texted him on my phone to tell him that I was streaming and he left me alone. I hoped that would be that, but my mic had picked up his voice, and everyone watching my stream was able to hear him. Messages instantly flooded the chat, asking who the male voice in the background was. I ignored them at first, again not wanting to break character or reveal that I had a brother. Donnie immediately lost it. He immediately disconnected from the game and hopped into my chat with a series of increasingly disturbed messages, all with $100 donations attached to grab my attention. My little nightshade, who's that? My queen, are you all right? Is that man in your house going to hurt you? Please say something. I don't know what I'd do if you were hurt by that ruffian. Don't worry, my little nightshade. My blood shall save you. I had no idea what he meant by that, but I elected to just ignore him this time. The buzz about my brother's voice eventually died down as the stream went on without me bringing attention to it, and Donnie didn't send another message for the rest of the stream. Once everything was wrapped up, I had dinner with my brother. I told him about Donnie, but he assured me that VTubers had to deal with stuff like that all the time, and that having a creepy, obsessive fan was a sign that I was starting to get popular. We laughed it off, and I forgot about Donnie. My brother went to bed early while I browsed my social media on the living room couch, making posts in character as my VTuber persona. I was thinking of what game I could play for the next day's stream, when a knock came from my door. I was startled, but assumed that it was a night delivery for something my brother ordered. "I'm coming," I called out as I walked to the front door. The moment the words left my lips, I heard a raspy voice come from the other side of the door. "My little nightshade?" it said in perverse excitement. I'd never heard the voice before in my entire life, but I immediately knew who it was. Nobody else called me my little nightshade. "Donnie?" I blurted out before I could stop myself.
"You remember me?"
Donnie shouted in joy from the other side.
"I knew you felt the same way."
I didn't reply. I just stood in front of the door frozen in fear, while Donnie professed his devotion to me from the other side and begged to be let in. How the hell did he even get my address? I could only assume that he traced my IP address somehow. When I offered no response, Donnie's knocks turned into violent bangs.
"It's that bastard in your home keeping you locked in there, isn't it?"
he shouted angrily.
"Don't you worry though, I'll give you all the strength you need."
I kept my mouth shut. I knew Donnie was disturbed before, but now I know that he was certifiably insane. I just peeked through the peephole of my apartment door so that I could give the police a physical description when I made a police report. I saw a dirty, disheveled young man with long black hair matted with grease and a sickly pale face covered in bleeding warts. His teeth were yellowed and crooked, twisted into a blood-curdling grin.
"My unsullied blood shall liberate you. Drink from it and find the strength to break free, my little nightshade."
I watched in horror as he brought a knife up to his own throat and stabbed it in the side. With both hands, he dragged the blade across his own neck until a river of blood gushed out like water out of a broken dam. All the while,
His crazed, bloodshot eyes never stopped staring at the peephole he knew I was watching from. I only snapped out of my stupor when his blood flowed under the door gap, and I felt its warmth as it touched my bare feet. I called the police and explained what had happened. Donnie had lived in the same city as me, and like I suspected, traced me through my computer. Although he was known to be an expert at computers, he was also mentally disturbed enough to think that a vampire girl who only existed on a computer screen was real. Since that night, I've avoided ever showing myself online. My brother assured me that it wasn't my fault, but in a way, I had enabled his unhealthy behavior by accepting his donations and giving him the attention he wanted from it. I should have seen the signs so much sooner. I've since abandoned my Miyako Nightshade persona. That way, Donnie will be her last and only victim.